Hi there, it's Jeff Watts here, and welcome to episode 95 of the Remote Agile podcast. The good news is that restrictions seem to be easing here in the UK, so there's a good chance that in the not too distant future, we may be able to get back to a real podcast. But we'll wait and see. For now, we're still recording these from our relevant homes, and this week we were looking at Challenge 4 from Scrum Mastery Challenge Lockdown Edition. It was supposed to be Challenge 3, but, let's just say requirements can sometimes be misunderstood and we might need to inspect and adapt. So what was Challenge 3 is now Challenge 4, and this week we were asking our contestants to start an online conversation, and we were going to be rewarding things based on their contribution. And it was a really tricky challenge, perhaps harder than we thought, perhaps something to do with the pandemic, perhaps not. We explored that. And there were a number of interesting approaches to how they went about tackling this challenge, which gave us some good content for the podcast. And at the end of it all, there were a number of interesting changes in the leaderboard. We hope you find it interesting. The competition is certainly hotting up. We'd love to hear your conversations that you started. Tag us, post them in the comments, tweet us, and the best ones we might mention on a future episode. But for now, stay safe, stay cool, stay happy, and stay hydrated. Take care, everyone.
Ba-dum-bum-bum-bum. Look at us with our posh microphones now.
Oh, most people won't be able to, but hopefully they'll be able to hear, hopefully they'll be able to hear the difference. There, we're changing our setup every week, inspecting and adapting continuously. Hopefully this is even better than the last one. So, hello, mate.
Hello, buddy.
Bit of middle of the day recording today.
Yeah, it's not really pub time. The pubs have only just opened. If pubs were open, it's on my clock now, it's 10 past 12, and they'd just have opened for lunchtime drinking. But I'm not going to lunchtime drink today.
I've got too much on this afternoon. Same here. So I've got some... I won't do the brand because we don't get paid or sponsored. So it's a bubbly spring water. Bubbly fruit juice, I think it is. Basically,
okay. Fizzy pop.
Yeah, it's not guilty. It's not guilty.
Okay. I've got water. Mm. Shall I do a review of my water drinking? Oh, yeah. Tastes like apples, Jeff. No, it's not.
Right.
It's good. It's iced water. It's very refreshing on this fine July morning, afternoon,
evening. Okay, good. All right. So we are we're still in the middle of Scrum Mastery Challenge lockdown, and we are reviewing another challenge.
Yeah, I feel this one was probably one of the more complex ones. And yeah. It took a few explanations, didn't it, of what we were kind of looking for here.
Yeah, there was... I thought the first thing we were going to be debriefing here was how easy it is to misinterpret.
Yeah.
Even though they weren't necessarily written requirements, they were verbal requirements. We thought we'd explained it pretty well, but basically everyone misunderstood us on the first go. So we gave them another chance. We gave them all another chance. We reset, which is why this one's a little bit out of order. This was meant to be Challenge 3, but it's turned into Challenge 4. So they had a little bit longer to do it. You want to give us a brief overview of what the challenge was?
Yeah, so what we were looking for was our contestants to start an online conversation. And basically, we were going to reward the biggest contribution that conversation brought back. Mm. So to the community, to the Agile community. So we're looking for levels of interaction and levels of comments and kind of reaction from the Agile community as to what those new conversation that our contestants started since during this task.
Yeah, we always try and leave a little bit of ambiguity in the challenge to encourage different ways of looking at it. So we weren't specific in saying it had to be the amount of contribution it gave to the Agile community. We tend to the most contribution, the more contribution, the better. So that could have been the number of people involved. It could have been the actual quality or the deep level of thought or just newness or challenge or whatever. So yeah, we eventually got some responses, and it was a tough one. We both felt a little bit, this was probably the hardest of all the challenges for people.
But again, so the kind of the contestants went with different approaches, which I perhaps didn't foresee that. I thought everyone might do the same type of thing, but there were some differences of approach here, which will be interesting to debrief.
So where should we start? Who should we start with?
Let's start today with Team USA.
Okay, Team USA. So we've asked them to do a short 30-second sort of debrief, if you like, of what they got from this and what they thought. So here's Team USA's reflections.
On Twitter, we asked the question, what's something you did this week to create and hold space for everyone on your team?
The most impactful response we really liked was from Mark. He talked about silence does not always equal agreement. So after asking a question, take 10 to 15 seconds to let the team really think about and answer the question. So we really liked the power of silence for giving people time for them to think and use their voice.
So there, they started a Twitter conversation, which is fine, right?
That's kind of, I suppose, where I thought most of these online conversations might emerge in kind of some of the major social media platforms. So it's not surprising we had a Twitter, a short punchy tweet to try and invite a conversation.
And play to your strengths, right? So they obviously have two people, as all the other countries which have one. So they had twice the potential number of followers to interact with.
Yep.
And they're not to be penalised for that.
No. And equally, they could start that conversation between themselves, pretty much.
Yeah.
If they could play those two sides of that conversation out on Twitter, and that might again do more when people see more replies. That generally creates more interest, and that's something worth getting involved in. So
they didn't, though.
They didn't do that.
But they could have done. That idea of once something started, it's easier to join in. No one really wants to be the first person. Well, not nobody, but
a lot of people. Hard to be the first follower.
First person to follow or to comment or to question or challenge. So they asked a very open question, wasn't it? So what's something you did this week to create and hold space for everyone in block capitals on your team? So it was about inclusivity and about space.
Yes.
They picked out silence, not necessarily equaling agreement. That was their takeaway from it.
Yeah.
And I think that's an interesting, an important, interesting thing when you're looking at making sure everybody's involved. Don't make assumptions about things. What were the stats on that, referee?
So we thought we'd play back some numbers in terms of trying to measure, and obviously, Jeff, this is entirely your decision, but when it comes to it at the end of it, but these might just help you. So if you just make a note of these as I read them out. So the actual tweet had 8 replies. So that's 8 kind of responses, text responses to the tweet itself. 10 retweets. So 10 people retweeted that and shared it, and 4 likes.
Okay.
So it gives you a bit of an idea as to the level of interaction the level of
guide
contribution maybe that had.
Yeah, I think from an interaction contribution point of view, that's interesting metrics. The actual contribution to the genre is probably more subjective. I like the fact that they picked an inclusive topic, made people think, and something that even if people didn't consciously interact with it, I can imagine it would have made a lot of people think, and maybe their response was, oh, I haven't, but then they went away and did create and hold space for everyone on the team somehow, and they would have looked at those replies, that back and forth about how silence doesn't necessarily mean agreement, and thought, oh, I'm gonna just check in with people who are silent and just make sure that everything is okay and they're not just holding back. So I think
it's very hard to obviously for us to see that and for us to see the benefit of that. It might not happen in the next few days, it might happen in the next few months or years, but it might be a longer burner.
Okay, that's a good start, Team USA. Where are we going next?
Let's mix it up a bit this week. Let's go to Jags.
Any reason for that?
No. Should I pick a different one?
No, that's fine. Because Jags was the one person who didn't manage to get his entry in.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, Jags.
So, so unfortunately, Jags did have an idea for a conversation, but we never got the actual report. We didn't see the conversation. We didn't get to see his debrief of it. So we can't judge it. We can't score it, unfortunately.
So, yeah, I'm afraid as a referee here, Jeff, I have to wade in here and kind of give my edict here. This would be a 0 point contribution harsh. Here from it, it's harsh, but it's the rules.
It's the rules. Them's the rules.
And he missed the deadline. So sorry, Jags. You thought you were going to be next, but we've got nothing to talk about. So no points. 0 points. Nil point.
Okay. Don't rub it in. Move on.
Right. Let's go to Anshul this week.
Anshul. Okay, so let's have a quick recap of what Anshul went through. And again, as Anshul is Anshul, not a lot of talking.
No.
Fly me to the moon. Let me play among the stars. Let me see what spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, hold my hand.
So just a little bit of music for you there. Obviously,
musical interlude.
If you're watching,
he does always put, I like a bit of, it's very soothing. The music he chooses is very soothing.
Yes. If you're watching the video, then you would have seen a kind of slideshow presentation of what the conversation was and a little bit of his own data metrics, if you like. So for everybody else's benefit, what was the conversation that he started?
So it was kind of an invitation to ask people how the Scrum values have inspired them in their lives and in their work or their personal lives. And he was willing to reshare some of those stories as a method to pass on some positivity, I think.
Okay. And he didn't do this on Twitter.
No, and I was, so this was a little bit new to me, because you're a bit more of an expert in how he did this.
Expert. I have used Medium in the past.
More than I have, Jeff.
Yeah. Medium, so basically a blog post, effectively. And he captured people's contributions and then published them in the blog post, as it were. So it wasn't a case of he started the conversation, other people joined in online. He sort of published the contributions that he got and then invited more people to join in on the back of that. So he kind of broke that first responder, first follower thing in safely and gently. So if anybody was joining in, they were already joining into other people's contributions. Although we have no evidence, not that we doubt Anshul's integrity in any way, but we have no proof that those people actually said those things.
Mm. No.
He could have just made them up.
And then they could have, well, there's no, equally as a referee here, Jeff, I'd be looking to question, did those interactions happen, you know, after the initial deadline of giving the task? They could have been stored on a hard drive from maybe months or years ago.
This is true. Do you have any stats for me, referee?
So yeah, to try and help you along with your decision here, Jeff, I have just 5 likes here and no comments on that blog post.
Okay.
So, it to me as a referee here, it just seemed a little bit. It wasn't much conversation that came out of that, and hence there was no comments on this. It didn't seem to any dialogue. It just seemed to be a bit more of a hearts and minds type of sharing exercise here, and I for me personally, I think when it terms into a conversation, I'd expect to see a bit of toing or froing, or maybe it's just because it's what harder to see on Medium. I don't know.
Well, I don't know how much the typical Medium post gets in terms of comments. I would imagine something like Twitter, like Team USA use, probably has more, but the responses that you get on Medium are possibly more focused and targeted.
Okay.
Because you can get just anyone, any troll posting an unhelpful comment on Twitter, whereas on Medium perhaps not so much. I don't, that would be my opinion. But it wasn't a conversation, I would say, simply because nobody replied. It had the potential to be a conversation, but maybe the way that it was phrased didn't invite conversation as much. Perhaps that might be why. For what it's worth, I mean, I like the topic. You know, I like the idea of taking those Scrum values and applying them to your personal life. As you know, I'm quite sad. I use Scrum and Agile in my personal life anyway. So the actual values, it's fine.
Wait, so again, just to, you were never really going to get, I don't think you get many people disagreeing with that. Is that fair?
True. So, I mean, yeah, that's a good point. Maybe you would. I don't know. I suppose it depends whether it's in a particular forum, how it's.
It depends on your audience, yeah.
Yeah. I guess what I'm inferring from that comment is that a conversation is richer if you have the potential for disagreement.
Mm.
You don't want it to be an echo chamber.
No.
Just your yes men following you saying yes, everything you'd say is true. I think in terms of contribution, I think being able to question our own assumptions, to be able to see the other side, to be able to empathize, I think those are richer conversations, more contributory conversations. They need to be handled well, of course, because it can get a little bit inflammatory, and get a little bit debatey, which debate's a good thing, but maybe if it gets a bit personal, maybe not so much.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so all right, so that's three down. Who's next?
Let's go to Mike.
Mike. Okay, so we gave people a 30-second time limit this time, and Mike's approach this week was to basically record as long as he wanted and then just cut it at 30 seconds. So in the middle of a sentence, he just stops.
So I haven't started a new conversation this week, but I've added people to a conversation that I've been having. So that's the best I've got. A couple of weeks ago, I started to offer my time on a Friday for free to people of color who would like some agile coaching. It's my way of offsetting some of the injustices that have been happening. It's not much, but it's a start. And this week, a fourth person has come on board, so I'm really pleased about that. I'm just
so yeah, there's Mike's views, and a very worthwhile cause. We're not judging the actual virtue of the conversation or the contribution here, so there's no points for morality, as morally vacuous as we may be appearing in that regard. This is purely around contribution. And the conversation. So from a rules perspective, have any rules been broken here? Are we all good?
No, I think we're okay. Yeah, we're good. I kind of had to do a bit of searching, but I went back to find Mike's original LinkedIn post where he offered his services.
Mm-hmm.
I'll give you some stats on that if you like.
Yeah, go for it.
So it was of all the conversations, the posts that I went through, this had the most interaction, if you like. So this had, I think, 95 likes, 10, I think a total of 114 interactions, which included 95 likes and 11 comments. So a lot of people responded to that and got involved in that conversation.
Okay.
And I think he did say, didn't he, I think up to four people have taken him up on that offer.
Yeah.
To get some coaching, so that's a nice.
When it comes to contribution, the fact that people have actually taken action,
yes,
joined a conversation that they wouldn't have joined normally, I think that's quite a big impact.
Mm. Obviously, hard to judge whether those conversations have had contribution in themselves, because they're private coaching conversations. But the start in that conversation has proved to be, valuable in that sense.
Yeah, good stuff. What else? Who else next?
Well, let's go to all the way over to New Zealand now, and our friend over there, Mr. Greg. Let's have a chat with Greg.
Okay, so we don't really have a video from Greg, so we'll have to explain this ourselves. So Greg started a conversation on LinkedIn, or attempted to start a conversation on LinkedIn, about what he calls "uh-oh" moments, or what
we
call failures or accidents or embarrassments or just things that didn't go to plan, and invited people to share them and what they took out of them. So could you turn an uh-oh moment into an aha moment? And he shared his own, where he attempted to gamify something. It didn't quite work. People didn't understand it particularly well. And he took an aha moment out of that. So stats?
So 12 likes on LinkedIn.
Yep.
And unfortunately, no comments.
Okay. And he iterated on this, which was quite interesting. So he started the conversation and he got some feedback from somebody. It wasn't public feedback. It was private feedback. And the feedback, and Anshul had some feedback like this, which they didn't really feel safe sharing these kinds of uh-oh moments on the internet. So you're taking quite a vulnerable topic, how something you tried not worked, and putting it into a very, very public space. And that psychological safety might not be there, even if you could hide by, it might be safer on Twitter because you could have a little bit more anonymity. You could have a weird Twitter handle. Whereas if you're on LinkedIn, this is your professional.
It is you, yeah.
Right, isn't it? It's you, and job hunters are going to be looking at these things. Now, as much as you and I can say, actually messing up is fine. It's what we learn from it. We can't guarantee that job hunters are going to take that view, right? So, so he iterated. He tried to make it a little bit safer, and he also put himself out there and showed his own vulnerability and said, "Look, I've done this, and it turned out okay." And
he also did something I don't think anyone else did, which was he personally tagged yourself and myself in his post.
Well, that brought a lot of attention, didn't it? We got notifications about
it. So I certainly was attracted to that by being big tagged there. I think he could have gone even further with that, and he could have asked us a direct question, or asked anyone a direct question within the post, rather than just tagging names onto the end of it. That might have created that first comment back. It might have been, it didn't have to be me or you, but it could have been someone that he thought might be interested or might be willing to share something.
Yes.
Follow him there.
Yes. I'll be honest, I was hesitant, not because I'm scared to admit when I've messed up, because I've done that publicly many, many times. Just listen to some of these episodes. more a sense of the integrity of the competition. Yeah. Should I be favouring one contestant over another? So I was hesitant. I resisted. But I think that idea of tagging people in, which invites them specifically into the conversation, it's kind of saying, I really want to hear your opinion on this.
Mm.
And it's perhaps a little bit harder for them to say no, to stay quiet.
Yeah.
And it can get the ball rolling, as you say. And so I think that's a good idea. Another thing that he did was, I think he limited, in his second iteration, he limited who could see it. So rather than being completely public, which you could search for on Google, he limited it to just his connections,
mm-hmm.
which was a slightly safer audience. But I'm not sure whether everybody looking at it would have known that.
No, it's not immediately obvious on LinkedIn as to where the level of audience that you have, or the post actually, how far it reaches.
So there's a balance to be struck here, isn't it? You don't want just the echo chamber of people that naturally are going to say nice things to you or just always agree with you. You want that different perspective. You want the debate. You want the divergent opinions and thoughts. But the smaller the audience, the more targeted the audience, the safer the space. So finding that balance is a tricky one. Okay, good. Who else have we got?
We've got, I think, two left on my list. Let's go to Stefan.
Okay, Stefan. Here's Stefan's reflections.
The challenge of starting a conversation was quite hard for me, since I do not post regularly and so no one seemed to answer. Luckily, on my third try, one of my colleagues stepped in and we had a small exchange about our learning experiences. My favorite moment was when his story triggered a new, even more interesting question about communication in general. But sadly, no one new joined in, and so the thread ended quite soon.
Stefan, bless him. Very, always humble.
Yeah.
I didn't really have much of an online presence. not many people responded, and it died. It died. But he did get a response, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a conversation, definitely a conversation. And stats?
One like, five comments. So, because I think when you're trying to increase contribution and dialogue and conversations, I think comments are good.
Mm.
I think in some respects, I'd look at comments, give them carry a bit more weight. But then I'm not awarding points here for this, but I think personally, comments for me carry a bit more weight. It requires more effort for someone to comment than it does just to like something, doesn't it?
Yeah, likes are cheap. Buy likes, but you can't buy conversation.
Well, exactly. What I liked about Stefan's is it was a much more direct request for comments. And I think that's probably why he got comments, because he said at the beginning of his post, I'd like to hear your thoughts, or I'd like you to post your thoughts and comments about this topic. And then he named his topic. You compare that to Team USA, Faye and Rob, where their tweet was literally just a question.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes being a bit more direct, I think, can focus people on saying, I'm being explicit here. I'd like you to reply to this. I'd like to know what you think. So I like that. It was more direct. And it did use a bit more extreme language. So this was perhaps the only example of this, I think, that we saw the most extreme example. I think he used the phrase a bloody beginner or something like that. So to give extremes in an argument to try and that, again, it's potentially quite inflammatory. It's potentially quite risky because you might divide opinion. But that might start a conversation or create awareness of a conversation in a wider community a lot quicker. I'm not saying it's always going to give you the best results, but it might have given you a bit more exposure. But I think that should be acknowledged that he did use a bit more of a direct, more extreme approach, I think.
Conversation has to be noticed.
Yeah.
Yeah, and especially, so Stefan pointed out that he doesn't have a huge online presence, doesn't have like hundreds or thousands of followers or what have you. So you have to get noticed. And that, for a scrum master in an organization, a change agent within an organization, you do have to build a network somehow. You do have to be heard somehow.
Yeah, find a voice. Yeah.
That is about changing the terminology, changing the jargon, just getting a conversation started somehow, obviously without offending people.
Credit to him, I think Stefan as well, he did respond to those comments. So yes. when someone did ask, give their thoughts, in a couple of cases, he replied to those comments. So if you do want a conversation, you have to be present in that conversation rather than just leaving an inflammatory tweet and then stepping back.
Mm.
Be prepared to, respond to people respectfully.
I'm going to have to overlay my interpretation on this, but I think it's an important point just at the higher level of the generic conversation piece, in that if you want people to really get involved in a conversation, then if you're asking a question, I believe that you're going to get more input if the people who you're asking the question of believe that there isn't in your head a correct answer. And I would say, again, from my interpretation, the way that Stefan asked the question implied that he didn't believe there was a right answer, which makes it easier for people to say, well, this is what I think, or this is what I've seen, or this is what I've done, because they're not worried about being told, well, that's a nice answer, but it's not the right answer. And I think that's really important for people like Scrum Masters, for coaches, for change agents, to be able to start a conversation with a question where people can actually explore it safely in that context.
Mm.
So I thought he phrased it, he positioned it well, and when you said, like you said, when he replied to the comments, he welcomed those comments and he wanted to explore them neutrally rather than is your idea better than mine kind of way.
Yeah.
So I thought he did that well.
So I don't think we should necessarily penalize him just because maybe, as in his own words, he doesn't have a massive online presence or a following. So I don't think that's necessarily degrades the quality of the conversation that emerged.
So our final contestant?
So I think finally this week it's Vikas, I think, on my list.
So someone's videos we always look forward to seeing.
From the conversation. I'm I can gather that meeting client expectations is first and foremost priority of an engagement. Customer is the queen. We need to think out of the box to deliver the business value faster and earlier. Scrum is one framework to achieve this. However, in difficult situations where there are unsolvable impediments, we might have to build deviations to meet the needs.
And it's another Vikash video. So
yes,
with filters and sound effects and all sorts. And I like, it's almost, so if you know, and a lot of our listeners know, I'm a big fan of puns. I'm a big fan of wordplay and irony and things like that. And I love the fact that, you know, he started off by having some noise overlaid on top of what he was trying to say, implying that actually a lot of conversations are just noise and you have to filter that out before you get to actually the key message. I thought that was quite clever.
It's a fair point.
So generally the view that Scrum can be used without realizing the value. You can have visibility without necessarily getting the value from that visibility, because it can easily be skewed. One of my favorite stories of all time involves that. Just because you've got a burn down on the wall doesn't mean it's true. Just because we're having a daily Scrum doesn't mean we're telling the truth. And that sense of, are we losing perspective here? Are we losing perspective? So that Vikas went down the medium route like Anshul did. And I was actually invited in to see the process. So you weren't.
I must admit, Vikas felt a bit, I felt a bit left out here. So I'm just about getting over it now. It's okay. It's fine. I won't take offense much.
I asked how he was going about doing it, and he explained that he posted it to a couple of Slack groups for feedback, his idea, before he drafted the article.
Open Slack groups or closed?
I believe that you require an invite, so that I think they're closed Slack groups.
Yeah.
So there's upsides and downsides to that. I think you've got more targeted, focused people. It's perhaps a safer environment because you know anyone's contributing, and the comments that you get are perhaps more valuable as a result. Perhaps there's less noise going on there. And actually, a lot of these people, they're volunteers, but they were giving their time to a sort of collective cause to make sure that good quality articles got published rather than just any old articles.
Okay.
So I got to see the evolution of his idea into a draft, into a published blog post. And it was a really good blog post around transparency and how not necessarily how transparency isn't necessarily always going to be useful if it's biased or if it's overly influenced. So interesting way of doing it. In terms of stats.
So what I've got here is 11 likes, but no comments.
Okay.
That's what the data is telling me.
Yeah. So I can see the comments from within the Slack group. So I can see the conversation that went into it. Nobody else can.
But in terms of the actual finished article,
that's
the public facing element of it. Is that right?
Yeah.
So you might have to, you'll have to judge that as best you can with bearing that in mind in that case. Is it a similar thing for Anshul then? That kind of, was there in kind of more internal feedback that we, sorry?
I don't know. I don't know whether that was the case or not. You don't have to go through that process. You can just.
Oh, I see.
But you can draft it and you can invite people to comment on drafts. So I don't know which approach Anshul took. I know he also used the same Slack channel one of the same Slack channels that Vikash used, but I didn't see the back and forth within that one on Anshul's. So, all right, I'm going to have to think out loud a little bit here. So why did we set this challenge? Well, when we talked about it, we thought, Agile is a lot about communication. It's a lot about people talking to one another. There often isn't a right or wrong. We need to challenge our assumptions. We need to talk things through. We need to explore new ideas. You want to invite new ideas. You want to invite people into conversations. When you're looking to make change, whether it's within a team or an organization, communication is absolutely key. And the fact that we're in lockdown means that communication is even more important, because you don't have as much of the what we used to call in BT osmotic communication, the stuff that's just going on around you and you're just picking up and absorbing without actually being a direct participant in the conversations. You don't have that as such. So having in your locker, having in your toolkit, the ability to start conversations, to keep them going, to make them useful, I think is a really important skill. So I guess we're looking at that sort of out loud thinking is helping me work out how I'm going to judge this. So even if, you know, the online world is massive and there's lots of potential, actually getting a conversation started is not trivial. You know, there's so many conversations out there that people can be participating in. Why should they participate in yours? Mm. How do you get your message seen amongst all the millions of tweets and posts and blogs and everything that's all out there already? And so first of all, being able to get that attention, as it were, is important. Is it targeted? Do you go big bang? Do you try and tag? Do you try and have a focused audience? So that I'm looking at, you know, whether it was interesting enough, whether it was safe enough, whether there was back and forth. So I'm kind of looking at all of those things. Now, you've already told me that Jags is going to score none on this.
I'm afraid so. Yeah, that's an easy one, Jeff.
I've only got a split six. So where to start? I mean, if you're just looking at, well, I think there are two reasons why I'm going to give first place here. One is around pure numbers, and the other is around action over talk. So I believe the best conversations should enable and inspire action. And I think Mike's did.
Okay.
It has the most, I'm not judging this on a moral perspective at all. Simply, he had a lot of interaction, a lot of response. I think there was a certain element of risk that he took. Maybe he saw that, maybe he didn't, I don't know. And just that humility in a, you know, it's not much, but it's something. And when you're trying to make a change happen, for me, it's not the big things. It's the accumulation of the little things. It's when you see people think, all right, this is only a little thing, but it's worth doing, that it inspires more little things. And that's how big things happen. So, it was, in his words, only a small thing. But it got four people into a conversation they hadn't had before, and actually doing something that could help significantly change a life or change a career. So I'm giving Mike first place.
How many points is Mike getting? Are you going to come back to that later?
yeah, let's come back to that at the end.
Okay.
So far, in a lot of these challenges, I've grouped people together, but I'm going to try and force myself to split them apart a little bit more this time.
Now we're getting towards the business end of the challenges as well, so that people are paying a lot of attention. Every point can make a difference on this leaderboard now, Jeff.
Yeah. So second place, it's a tough one. So I think my instinct is to group them together, but I'm gonna be tough. I'm gonna push myself. I'm gonna say Team USA is gonna come second.
Okay.
I think it was an interesting topic to have a conversation about. I think it's an important topic to have a conversation about. I think it's an even more important topic to have a conversation about in lockdown, because it's easier for people to stay silent and not notice.
Yeah.
And that assumption, if we can challenge our assumption about that, it makes it easier for us to challenge our other assumptions. And I think that's a really important thing to do. They did it in a safe way, in a non-provocative way, in a drawing people out way. And it did get some traction. So, you know, there was a lot of love for that. There was some retweets, some likes, some comments.
Yeah.
And I imagine a lot of people actually took that away. Even the ones that didn't comment, I thought there was potential for reflection. So I thought that's number two.
Okay. Number three?
Yeah, close behind Stefan. I think hard to pull them apart, but I think the only thing going there was perhaps stats in that regard. I don't necessarily, even if it was just one conversation between two people, it was a good conversation. Mm-hmm. He framed it well, which invited more people. And if he were to work on some of the tactics that we've talked about, you know, directly including people into the conversation, inviting people into the conversation, developing his network, maybe cross-platform would increase that.
Yeah.
There are tactics that people can use to build their networks in this challenge, but also in their organizations. And that would have perhaps tipped him into the top two. But he's, I think, third place is
yeah, it's an honourable third place for Stefan. Very good.
It's a tough challenge. Okay, so where next? I'm going to give credit here for actually the inspecting and the adapting and the specific tactics of inviting people into the conversation. So Greg's going to get fourth place here for me. He did get, okay. He did get a number of likes.
Yeah.
And it was definitely a conversation that he attempted to start. Mm-hmm. There was some response, although it wasn't a public response, and he used that response to iterate, to try and make it even more inclusive and more safe for people to join in. I imagine it's probably started a lot of conversations off platform.
Yeah.
Even if it's just amongst yourself. So I can have a conversation with myself. Sometimes they're some of the best ones I have. Yeah, just that sense of, so what has gone wrong? And actually, what did I take from it? So I think that was a good conversation to start. Just above Vikash, just. So I'm putting Vikash in fifth here.
Okay.
So I liked the actual topic. I liked the quality of the article. I liked the fact that he was vulnerable while drafting it, getting feedback before he thought it was ready. I thought that was a vulnerable thing to do. He made it safe for himself in a closed forum, and it did get a few likes. And I think over time it will get even more. We did give him a very limited time frame to get interaction. So fifth, and then I think just. Similar kind of thing with Anshul, except that I didn't see the iterations. I didn't see the evolution of it, and got slightly less metrics for the same forum. So,
okay,
Anshul in sixth place.
Wow, what a fall from grace for our top of the leaderboard, Anshul at the moment.
I suppose, yeah. I don't.
Big surprise. In some respects, a shock result, Jeff, for many people, I imagine.
Well, it just goes to show, isn't it, that all these challenges, they're drawing on different skills.
Yeah.
And no one is going to be, have a 10 out of 10 or a star in every skill set. And sometimes we get to play to our strengths, sometimes we get to develop our other areas. And I think it's a healthy sign.
Cool. So how are we going to score this then?
Well, I think my instinct is to stick with the normal scoring mechanism. So winner 7 points.
And then count down. So Mike, Mike 7.
Mike 7.
I've got Robin Faye 6.
Yep.
I've got Stefan 5.
Yep.
Greg 4.
Yep.
Then I've got Vikash
3.
And Anshul 2. And unfortunately, Jags doesn't even get 1 point. He just gets 0 points.
It feels harsh, but it's the rules.
Harsh but fair. Okay. Let's plug those into the leaderboard and see how that plays out. We've updated the leaderboard. And let's go from bottom to top. So it's starting to open out a little bit now. So in seventh place now we have Jags. After his... 0 nil points in that round. He's got 13 points. Then in sixth place, we've got Stefan with 14. Vikash is next with 15, closely followed by Greg with 16. So the top three now look like this. We have Team USA shot up to third place with 17 points. Anshul's been relegated to second place, the silver medal position now with 19. And Mike is our new leader at the top of challenge number 4 with 22 points.
Well done, Mike. Well, well done, everyone. That was a tough challenge, actually. And as with all of the challenges, they've thrown themselves into it and had a great go, all of them. So, well, apart from Jags. No, I know. I'm pretty sure Jags did do it. He just didn't get it in time. Because we saw, he did tell us what he was going to talk about.
Yeah.
And we just never got to see it. So... it's all interesting, isn't it? It's still anybody's game with two challenges left.
All to play for, two challenges left. It's very, very, very close. Very close.
And I'd invite I invite our listeners to start some online conversations and see what they can start and how they go about doing it and what we can all learn. And maybe some of the best ones will feature on a future edition of the podcast. So go for it. Find your forum, find your audience, find a topic and see what you can come up with.
And it's an interesting point that it's nice to see that you could have manipulated this challenge, obviously, heavily in your favor. And it's nice to see that none of our contestants did that. But as we all know online, that controversy tends to bring awareness and attention, doesn't it? And then sometimes tweeting something or posting something around a controversial subject this element of agile doesn't, something that doesn't work or something that's quite destructive, can actually, I would see it personally, I know that you're the judge here, but I don't think that's necessarily adding contribution. That's just adding controversy. Mm. And they can be two very different things. I think debate is healthy, but I think that it's obviously a lot of people I've seen on Twitter and various other platforms before just use those forums to breed controversy, which isn't always the most positive and it's not always the most constructive way to build a following.
I agree. Yeah, so inclusive conversations, constructive exactly. conversations, inquisitive and curious conversations and challenging conversations, absolutely. But yeah, keep it respectful, everyone.
Yeah.
All right, well, thank you for that, referee. Until next time, stay safe.
Yes.
Stay happy.
Cheers.